All praise be to Allah and peace be upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Most of us dream to be independent from our daily work one day and own our own business where we are the boss and no longer have to take any orders from another. No stress, it's a simple idea, but so powerful. Freedom, freedom from financial burdens, freedom from taking orders, and freedom from the rat race. But what does Islam say about business, and does this freedom really exist? Good question. Let's analyze this together. The Quran speaks in many places about trade. Its main message is setting the rules for good trade. In particular, it establishes how to make trade fair and just. Trade is encouraged by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu la ta'kulu amwalakum baynakum bil باطل إلا أن تكون تجارة عن تراض منكم ولا تقتلوا أنفسكم إن الله كان بكم رحيما. So that means trade and business is the best thing for us, right? Not exactly. Sadly, most of the world today has been subjected to the Western idea of suppressive economics, which based on free market, capitalism, and interest. It may sound like a nice idea, but this concept of trade makes the rich more richer and keeps the poor very poor. It's very different to the Islamic trade. Furthermore, interest-based banking has plunged many nations into irreversible debt that will not ever be repaid in an entire life of a person. Thus, capitalism is a philosophy to acquire as much wealth as possible within as quick a time as possible. Interest is the evil tool that generates fake money through which a rich person or bank gets an unfair advantage over a poor person or country and buries them in debt. It's used by the unjust to oppress the needy. Today, the world is enslaved to debts by bankers who keep adding interest upon interest to oppress the needy and shackle them into economic slavery. Wow, that's really scary. So it means trade is unjust and creates gaps in society, right? Not exactly like you said. Trade is as good as the hand that holds a pen. Good people write good books, and evil people write lies and slander. Islam came to free humans from injustice. Both Islam and the Quran encourage fair trade and forbid riba in all its forms. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, goes further to forbid riba through direct or indirect ways too. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, "The selling of wheat for wheat is riba, except if it is handed from hand to hand and equal in amount. Similarly, the selling of barley for barley is riba, except if it is from hand to hand and equal in amount, and dates for dates is usury, except if it is from hand to hand and equal in amount. The harm of interest on an individual, community, national, and global level is evidence of why Islam forbids this evil, sinful act, and therefore a true Muslim will never deal in riba. They will protect the individual and the society as a whole. So business must be done with justice and fairness. How does Islam support that? Good question. To support this, Al-Quran recommends written contracts. How else would we assure a seller and buyer receives a fair exchange? We're obliged to write down our trade even amongst brothers. We're obliged to use fair measurements. Justice prevails in this way, as both parties are assured that the terms are clear and agreed to. There is no ambiguity, and they limit the harm from any future dispute, and we're not permitted to lie, deceive, or cheat in our trade. This means you must be clear in what you sell, buy, even if it loses value due to some defects.
Subhanallah. So Islam was teaching to use invoices, receipts, fair marketing,
and got customer service over 1400 years ago. That's amazing. But what about capitalism? Why is it so bad? In a free open market, I should be able to make as much money as I want. Sure, if your goal is to make money in a fair and just way, then it's possible. However, can you expect a person who becomes rich with greed to also treat others with fairness, to pay his zakat, to give a charity in the right manner, to refrain from using riba, to make fair contracts between people, and to do just to his suppliers and customers? No, it's a very hard task. And those with faith will surely find that conducting honest business can produce many challenges. Remember the ayah we read earlier, to distribute the wealth, not hoard it. The Prophet, peace be upon him, was the most honest man, as-sadiq al-ameen, the truthful and trustworthy one. He traded many places, but his personal property upon his death was very little. We must follow the best of examples. The mother of believers, Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha, reports, when the Prophet died, he didn't leave behind a single dinar or dirham, nor did he leave a sheep or a camel. He made no will. A similar hadith is related by al-Bukhari. At the time of his death, God's messenger left neither dirham or dinar, nor a male or female slave. Indeed, he left nothing other than his white mule, his personal arms, and a piece of land which he left for charity. And what did he say from his experience of the marketplace? The messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, the most beloved places to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the mosques, and the most hated places to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the marked. Traders will be gathered on the day of judgment as transgressors, except those who feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, were righteous and spoke the truth. This means that, for example, doctors are transgressors if they are not honest with their patients or are negligent. Engineers are transgressors if they are not honest about the status of their project. Salesmen are transgressors if they are not honest about their product. Anybody who gets a full salary but slacks off at work is a transgressor. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, indeed, there is a fitna for every nation, for every ummah, and the fitna for my ummah is wealth. Lastly, our purpose in this life is not to attain wealth at any cost. Our rizq is determined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so we must obtain it in a halal way. What is the benefit of freedom if you have to pay the price of your akhirah for it? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to the best path of halal rizq for us and our future generations. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.